Pop quiz, how big is an atom? All right, not that atom. Or that one. A-T-O-M. How big is an atom? This big? Yeah, you're probably a little smaller. Smaller? Smaller. Right, so small that we certainly wouldn't be able to see it on this video. In fact, it's so small that if we were to look at the head of a pin, there would be on this pin, of course, depending on the atom itself and the size of the head of the pin, about 1 trillion hydrogen atoms. 1 trillion. So yeah, atoms are really small. Really small. But the problem is, we deal with atoms every day, in every way. We see them as part of chemical compounds, or as part of a balanced chemical equation in some sort of chemical reaction that we rely on. But we're dealing with numbers of atoms. And the problem with atoms being so small is that they're really hard to count. So there's got to be something that helps us count these really, really, really small atoms and these really, really, really small molecules. And there is. And we call it the mole. Now, when you think of a mole, you might think of this, or maybe this, or if you're into Mexican food, maybe this. Mole! But when chemists think about the mole, we think about a number, and that number is 6.02 times 10 to the 23. Yeah, that's a really big number. How big is it? Well, it's this big. It's a lot of zeros. Now, when we deal with a number this large, it kind of makes sense when you think about it because atoms are extremely small. I think we've already talked about that. But they're so small that in order for them to be in a manageable quantity, we're dealing with a really, really, really large number of them. Now, how big is this number? That's really kind of hard to picture. But let's try. Here I have a stack of paper. Now, I don't really know how many sheets of paper are in here, but I know I have a lot less than a mole. In fact, if I had a mole of sheets of paper, and I were to make 1 million stacks of these sheets of paper, they'd reach pretty high. How high? Well, these 1 million stacks of paper would pass the sun, are you ready for it? 40 million times. 40 million. Seriously. Now, the nearest star to us, which is about 4.22 light years away, those stacks of paper, those same stacks of paper, would pass it about 15,000 times. 15,000 times. The next nearest star. That's a big number. So long story short, the mole is a really big number. 6.02 times 10 to the 23, something that we call Avogadro's number, named after Amadeo Avogadro, the individual responsible for first coining the term the mole and establishing molar volumes of gases. But this number is really necessary because if you think about it, we have to deal with large quantities of atoms and molecules and particles just because they are so small. So for us to observe them and for us to use them, we have to deal with large quantities of them. Now, in order to understand just how we use these values, let's just first think about cookies. That's right, I said cookies. Now, if you were to go to a store in order to buy cookies, you could go to a bakery and you'd probably order cookies by the dozen or half dozen, or you could go to the store and order them by the bag. Either way, you're buying them by a large quantity. And so there's conversions that we can look at between the total number of cookies and what we understand these values to mean. So for example, we could go to the bakery and order 2 dozen cookies. And if you order 2 dozen cookies, since you know what a dozen is, you could figure out the total number of cookies quite easily. We have an understanding that a dozen is 12, and if we order 2 dozen, that means there are 24 cookies. Now, in order to figure out that relationship, you have to know the value of a dozen, you have to know how many dozen you have, and you'd be able to figure that out. Similarly, if you went to the store and you bought a bag of cookies, likely on the bag is a mass. And if you were to know the mass of a dozen cookies, and you looked at the mass of the bag, you could figure out how many dozens there were in that bag, and then ultimately you could figure out how many cookies you had because you know how many dozen there are. And let's say that the number of chocolate chips in these cookies are standard, you could then figure out the total number of chocolate chips in the bag if you knew how many chocolate chips there were per cookie. Seems pretty logical, right? Well, let's connect this to an atom. Let's say we knew the mass of a particular substance. Well, there's got to be some way that we can convert from mass to number, and that is the key factor here, and that's where we use the periodic table. So if we look at the periodic table, we notice that we have a symbol on there, and that symbol, let's say for lithium, gives us some information. Lithium is atomic number 3, so we know that it has 3 protons. But we also see this mass number down here. Now, the mass number gives us the average atomic mass of this particular atom and its rated average of its isotopes, but it also gives us its molar mass. That is, the mass of 1 mole of this particular substance. So we know that lithium, if we have 1 mole of it, that is, we have 6.02 times 10 to the 23 atoms of lithium, it's going to have a mass of 6.94 grams. And we refer to this as its molar mass. And we can look at any element on the periodic table and establish its molar mass just by looking at this number that we see there. And in fact, we can figure out the molar mass of a compound if we take the individual molar masses of all of the elements in that particular compound. So for example, if we wanted to take the molar mass of water, we would have to understand that there are 2 hydrogens and 1 oxygen in that overall formula for the molecule. So we're going to have to take oxygen's molar mass of 16.00 grams per mole, add it to the mass of 2 hydrogens, because there are 2 hydrogens a part of this formula, and we would get 18.02 grams per mole. That is, 18.02 grams would equal 1 mole of water, or 1 mole of water would weigh 18.02 grams. Now, what relevance does this have for us if we're going to calculate it? Well, let's think back to our analogy of the cookie. Let's say instead of cookies, obviously we're dealing with molecules. Now, let's say we had a mass of a certain molecule. If we used its molar mass, we could then figure out the number of moles of that molecule. Since we know the number of things in a mole, we could then use Avogadro's number, say it with me now, 6.02 times 10 to the 23. Ooh, that felt good. Let's say it one more time. 6.02 times 10 to the 23. 6.02 times 10 to the 23. In order to figure out the total number of molecules that we have in that particular sample. And if we know the chemical formula, then we can figure out the number of any one of the atoms in the chemical formula that we have in that particular compound, much like we figured out the total number of chocolate chips that we had in a bag of cookies. And of course, there are established relationships or equations that we use in chemistry to help us out. And here they are. Now, these are 2 equations that you really need to know. In fact, the first one that I'm going to take a look at here, N equals M over big M, this is one that you're going to be using again and again and again, and it's the relationship that exists between the number of moles, the mass of a sample, and the molar mass of the compound in question. And we're going to be using this one over and over and over again. So the faster you know it, that is, the quicker you memorize it, the easier it's going to be. And the more you use it, and the more you're able to manipulate it and solve for any of those variables, the easier chemistry is going to be. Now, as we can see here, N, lowercase n, represents the number of moles. You're going to get used to seeing lowercase n over and over again. And we use the units mole, M-O-L, to represent the number of moles of a substance. Could be the number of moles of a molecule, could be the number of moles of an atom, could be the number of moles of an ion. We have a capital M representing the molar mass in grams per mole, and remember, we get that from the values on the periodic table. And of course, mass is represented in grams, which makes sense because we're dealing with molar masses in grams per mole. The other equation that we have here, I refer affectionately to as the na-na-na equation. And what it is it's a way for us to calculate the total number of entities or things within a given sample. So once we know the number of moles, lowercase n, we can then use Avogadro's number, 6.02 times 10 to the 23, to figure out the total number of entities or particles in that particular substance. Capital N representing the total number of things that we have, or entities as we call them. Lowercase n representing the number of moles, and n sub a representing Avogadro's number, or the value of a mole. Now notice these 2 equations can be used connected together, and you're going to be responsible for being able to do that. So let's go back to our sample analogy where we have a particular mass of a compound. We can use one of these equations to establish the number of moles, or lowercase n, that we have of a particular compound. And then if we find the value of n, we can sub it into the na-na-na equation, Since we know that 6.02 times 10 to the 23 is representative of the number of things in a mole, and we can figure out the total number of entities that we have in that particular compound. And then if we know the number of atoms, say in that a molecular formula, we can then figure out the total number of atoms that we might have in that given sample. So there's a whole bunch of different ways that we can use and manipulate these formulas to establish a number of different values that we may be looking for when given the mass of a particular compound. And of course, we can go the other way as well. If we have the total number of entities in a particular compound, we can ultimately figure out the mass of that particular compound or the number of moles of it. So hopefully, after watching this video, you have a better idea of why the value of a mole is necessary, just how small atoms actually are and how big the value of the mole is, and how to use these relationships in order to move between the number of particles, the number of moles, and ultimately the mass of a particular compound, or vice versa. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Did you not like the video? Was there something that seemed like it was a little off? Well, either way, we want to hear about it. So like us or leave a comment in the section below as to things that we could change or improve. And if you want to see more videos like this, you can subscribe to our channel on YouTube or follow us on Twitter.